purchase some of the colorful pictures we've been trying to decide on, or get some mind's eye view of what we'd like in terms of a paint job. It's never too soon to be dreaming. You know one thing about dreaming too? It's really inexpensive. You look around at some of these paint jobs and you think, The sand-colored camel one is one that appeals to me. This is another one that, with the checkerboard on the fuselage band. Just some of these things that we've managed to accumulate. And we've kind of sent out all the literature that we have, hoping that people would share it. And if they have an interest in a project, share their thoughts with us. But like the Spitfire project, we've been able to accumulate things, pick up some interesting ideas. It's been a whole lot of fun. Well, it's that wonderful time of day to get back down to shop. The shop is calling. We're going to take a little bit of a break from our Typhoon project. Mike's got his wing ready for the new Cardinal. What should we call this? Miss Janie 2?
Why not?
I don't know. Call it late for lunch. Okay, he's got the dope mixed up 50-50.
50-50.
How many coats you got on here? 4 or 5 coats?
Yes.
And sanded real nice in a truly professional manner. Okay, dope one up, baby. Now what we're going to do is he's got the tissue cut. We're going to take one sheet at a time. Take some Windex. We have some Windex and water mixed, which is a good, because it's cold. And what we want to do, main thing is when we do this panel, get the tissue to come as far over here, this panel here, so that we have double tissue right down the middle. That's one of the most important things. Okay, while you're doping that up.
Now, of course, if you don't have a helper, you got to work a little slower. Mike and I are used to working fast.
Time is money.
Money is money. Okay, I'm going to wet this. Again, it's half Windex, half water. Dampen it up. Get the dope on it. Okay.
You got the dope on it?
Open it.
Grab that side. You got the big side. Flip it over.
Give me the side.
Okay.
Okay, let's see, you go to your tip.
Go to your more.
More?
Right here.
That's it?
That's it.
Drop it.
You got the force of the dome cranked up.
Okay, rock away there, baby.
Now I use a method that some people may or may not appreciate, is the old bare hand method. Mike prefers a brush.
Believe me, once you do it bare handed, you'll never fool with that brush again. Okay, wrinkles will all come out of you. Dope that perimeter first of all. Before you do anything else, get the perimeter dope.
Okay. Just press the dope right down and it goes, get it wet.
Butchery as it may sound, that's the way that seems to work the best for me.
And the colder it is actually today, it's cold. Maybe like 40 degrees out.
Yeah, it's nice and slow now.
Yeah, it's going to take nice slow dry time now. Keep trailing the edge there. Almost over. Plus, if you're working alone, just take a little more time to get the old, go right down the edge. And you can dope this tip too. There you go. Okay.
But half happens when you press it down, you're pushing a dope right through down into the other side, so there's no chance it's not going to be. The brush really doesn't do that. Okay, now we'll work that tip.
It wrinkles out.
Okay, there you go. Now, even if you didn't, Mike, if you didn't pull these little wrinkles out, it wouldn't even matter. I'm just doing it because, basically, because you're such a cool guy. Okay. Always start as if it's a sunburst and you're pulling toward the edge. There you go. It's giving you time to smell the dope on it. It's dry. Keep it wet.
Side, this is still wet. As soon as it's just dry enough to the touch, even though the tissue is still wet, I want to flip it and do this panel. You never want to wait till one side dries to do the other side. Okay, you got the tissue wet already?
Yep.
Put it down. Okay, grab this one. Same thing, I got to get the belt frame to it up here. Back to you. To you. More.
Just pull it up with me, Mr.
Okay.
We got this.
Where's that knife?
Just put a cut here so we don't get around. Put some dope over here. Start working this out.
By the way, these jobs, this is one of the jobs that's... Try not to get any out on the tissue. It's just a lot easier if you can do it with a buddy or a friend or Mike. One second, I want to get that wrinkle out. And right up to the last minute, of course, you can still pull it off.
So that's why it ain't no secret.
There you go. Okay, you got that one. There's a lot of jobs in model aviation where if you have that second set of hands, like hanging a gutter on a house is Mike's favorite. Try hanging a gutter without a helper. Give me some dope down here. Okay. Get the tip with it if you can. That's good. But it's always good to do both sides of one panel if you possibly can. Use a Brodak dope, roughly 50-50 is what you get the mix going. And at 40 degrees, this is going to take about an hour to dry. Get that trail and inch there too. Okay, the other main thing is to get that when we get this done, we have double tissue in the middle. Now, if you didn't have that, you're compromising the strength in the middle of the wing some.
If I get both sides done, I like to sight the trailing edge and make sure that isn't crooked. Okay, now, if, as an example, if one side had already dried, like in hot weather, you could just re-wet the tissue, sprinkle it. There's nothing attaching this to the cap strips yet. When we do the doping of the tissue, you want this whole panel to shrink as one unit. Okay, you all set to go there, Spritzer?
Let's go.
All right, the other panel will be just like the first one, nothing different.
No secrets.
No secrets, right. Okay, flip it. We get the other side. We're done. You got the tail here too, right?
Yeah.
And the flaps are already done?
Flaps I did earlier this morning.
What a guy. Get over there and get that side done. Same thing. You got the tissue dampened up. See how we're working over a blanket so it isn't dripping wet. It's just damp. Or a towel is even good. Okay, baby, go. Go for it. And a nice cardinal length. Okay, what did you figure? 20 minutes for the whole job? You've been keeping track of the time?
Exactly, 20 minutes.
All right, now you got the tail, a stair, you did the flaps already. You got to do the elevators?
Yeah, 1, 2, 3.
Okay. Now, another trick is when you get to this point, the tissue is still dry. You want to get at least 1 or 2 coats of dope on the perimeter, and you want it to be totally dry before you put dope on the open bays, because you want it to hold in place as those open bays shrink. So you don't want to rush through. We need to let the edge is dry right now. If you were to take dope now and go out over those open bays before this is dry, it doesn't shrink as much as it should. It just kind of, you lose some of the shrink rate on it anyway. Okay. Boy, I'm telling you, you really know your stuff. Peeps is proud of you. He looks like a little criminal with those black feathers. He looks like he didn't shave. All right, Gonzo. Got the wing hanging up by a nail?
Yep.
Okay, ready to do the tail? Boy, I'm telling you, I am so impressed. I might have to give you 2 cups of coffee today. The truth is, without coffee,
don't go.
It takes 25 minutes to do a wing and tail. If you do a normal tail that has a joint in the middle, usually you want to do the same thing, double tissue. But since this piece of wood is tip to tip using the Miss Ashley way of building a tail. And by the way, if you haven't seen that video, Mike will sell you a copy. All right, baby, come on. My reputation is at stake here. You need a bigger brush, I think. That's the answer. Did you wet the tissue yet?
No. It's your job.
It's my job. Boy, oh boy.
I got to look at the job description for this one.
Okay. Okay, here you go.
Now let the front wrap around and get the trailing edge too from the horn out. So what I want to do is this blade is not the sharpest.
Just to be ready.
Well, hey. Okay.
Plenty of dope. Plenty of dope and use your bare hands.
No, not now.
I will
be with you when I'm far away. When I'm far, far.
Dope on it.
Try to get it under here if you can.
There you go. Okay, got it? That's good. Okay, pull that off of there. That's good. Okay, same thing up here. Do this one here. See, if you're doing a foam tail or you're doing a built-up like a nobler tail, you want to get double tissue in the middle because you have a joint there. You have to deal with that. Okay, let this, get that trimmer, trim that off. Leave a little bit on the leading edge so we could wrap that around too. It's better to have 2 layers of tissue than have a spot where you have no tissue. Press it right down. See, it's always better too, like in our case where we use that stooge, it's not a bad idea to have double tissue on the leading edge, right where the stooge goes anyway. That isn't going to hurt anything. Now look down the trailing edge, this side is dry. You see how it's got a little bit of a bow in it? So what we want to do is without wasting any time at all, and even if we have to keep this side wet, you want it to be that both sides dry at the same time. Once they dry, that'll be perfectly straight again, just like when it was original. All right, take this, wet it right down. So you don't want to waste any time when you get into this. You want to just get it, Do one side, flip it over, do the other side as quick as possible. Don't waste any time.
What it's going to do is wrap the second layer of tissue around here. And that's a real good insurance policy. That you always have these clowns launch your plane like, ah, you're holding your plane! Take care of business there, Bonzo. Okay. Plenty of dope.
There's always a couple of places on a plane where wherever you think it's going to take a lot of abuse, double tissue is a great idea. Middle of the wing. If you have a tail, a non-Miss Ashley tail with a joint in it, well, we're going to call it a Miss Ashley tail. It's a cardinal tail. Anyway, you got to come up with a name for this tail, the Mike tail.
There you go.
But that double tissue in the middle of the wing, boy, is that, that'll work. And some people, as Mike has said, we even had people in the club that think, oh, the glue won't stick to tissue. Look at that red plane with 25 million flights on it. Not a crack anywhere. So I guess there's, I guess we're wrong. Okay, wrap that right up. Finish your coffee and we can go warm up a little bit. Wet that second side, perfectly straight. And it can't get any straighter than that. It was built on a, what did you build this on, a piece of glass? I don't even remember.
Yeah, a piece of glass, definitely.
Okay. That's a great way to build a tail, by the way. And I would suggest anybody that has a cardinal kit already, just upgrade by copying the tail right off the Miss Ashley plans. For the same thing, just go to them, baby. I'll get the water going. What I always do is wherever hinge pocket is, slip the tissue. And let that tissue, the other side come this way. This way you're building up a little strength in every one of the hinge pockets. Same thing with the elevators. What we did, we put an extra layer of tissue here because we had sanded this sheeting kind of thin. But after that dope dries, you want to get both sides wet at the same time, then re-wet both sides and put it aside to dry, and it'll dry without a even a hint of a warp. If it's still wet, then just leave it. Let it sit an hour or so. In this temperature, it's going to take a little while to let everything dry. Line up everything on a table, Mike, so we can see when it's ready. And if I have to, I'll put a couple of coats on this tonight after it gets dark. But whatever you do, you want it from this point on. Anytime you dope one side, dope the other side. You don't want to ever dope one side and go have coffee. You could lay it. Now, see, you don't want to lay this out like this, Mike. Get little blocks or something. Because one side is on a tee. You want to kind of stand it up like this if you can, or something like that. Take the fuel jugs. Take some fuel jugs, because we want the air to be, especially in this cold temperature, let the cold be exposed to it. It's better to let it dry like that. Same thing with the wing. You'll just hang it up the other way.
Get some fuel on it.
No. All right, give it an hour to dry. That's the deal. And we'll put some coats of dope on it. Now, one of the other projects we're working on, and again, we're working on two projects at the same time, working on Mike's plane. We're working on trying to get these parts molded up. We finished the mold on our last tape. We're ready to do a layup. And we're ready to take care of building this mold up, the thickness we need. That's pretty well cured out. And finally, building the mold for the fuselage plug itself. Before we start this off camera, I want to give you a couple of things that I've learned over the years that really make this a lot easier than if you do it any other way. When you use silicone rubber molds, you don't need release agent, but I found by using smooth-on release, the spray, the mold lasts pretty much infinitely, and when you don't use it, you have a limited life. So to preserve the mold, since we put all this time into making it, I want to preserve it. This is funny, the first time I ever got to this point, what I did, I thought, oh, I mixed the resin, and I had not turned the heat down in the shop. I had the heat on, it was 72 degrees, I mixed the resin, oh, I'll cut one piece, and I'll cut, and by the time I did, half of the resin had cured. The resin, depending on the temperature, can have a very nice life, pot life, or a very short pot life. Now, I turned the heat down, the day I'm going to do a layup, I shut the heat off in the house, in fact. I'd rather be freezing and have that extra time. if you can put a couple of drops of epoxy dye in a resin, and what that allows you to do, you can see errors a lot easier than when you're working with cloth on top of cloth and you can't see where one ends and one begins, because it all kind of gets squished together there. This is an easy way to do it. Just put a little bit of dye, in this case I use black dye. Now you can also, and I do it right, as soon as I mix the resin up, I mix some filler with the same batch of resin so that I basically can make a paste to get in all the corners and edges. Now this mold has a few corners and edges. I don't know how the cloth is going to lay there, but almost always when there's a corner, a sharp corner, you want to fill that corner and then the cloth lays in much better. If not, you get a tremendous wrinkle or an air pocket in that corner. So having said this, we're ready to cut the material. Let's go lay up the mold for our test piece. Material for a cowl mold. The best thing that I've found, because it really bends around corners and edges and angles, is this real tight weave. It's sold by Florida Glue Products, but it's an extremely tight weave. So we're going to cut up our pieces with this and then maybe reinforce it with a piece or two of carbon, but I'll get all the pieces cut ahead of time. You might have noticed in the shop we have several different sizes and shapes of scissors. The reason is some of them are made specifically for cutting paper and the store brand, and we have a couple of pairs that have a curve in them, and we have a couple of pairs that are made for, specifically for cutting e-glass. And those tend to last a lot longer if you really want to spend the money. You also can use that. There's a cutting wheel like a pizza pie cutter that does a pretty good job. But you want to get nice edges, just buy a pair of the scissors that are made for this. In my case, because I don't do this very often, when a pair of scissors wear out, I just relegate it to the shop. That we just use it for scrap right now. And we always have a one or two pair that are really sharp. Some idea of the shape that's going to fit in there. And I can make it a little bit more triangulated. Again, you got to do this right. I'm going to cut a lot of half moons and a lot of round pieces to pack. Now, even though we're going to open that up, I want to have those pieces in there just to add rigidity to the part. Now, trust me, when you have any carbon fiber projects going on, you want to save all the scraps. In this case, because this stuff is about $100 a yard, we can use this very thin. This is 2.94 carbon. I can take some of my patterns, whichever ones I need to make in carbon, and just make them on my scrap pieces. We have all the various shapes, like a little cookie cutter that we think we're going to need. We're ready to mix the resin. The resin we use, it's called ProSet. I've had good luck making cowls with this. This is a resin that needs to be, well, the pumps meter it automatically. And the nice thing about this, it post-cures up quickly. And I've never had a part crack or chip or anything using this resin so far. So we're going to mix this up. And if you've never used these before, what's nice about these is, now you can see it's cold in the shop. The viscosity is very, the resin is very thick because it's really cool in the shop. I like to work in a cool environment. And again, the hardener makes it slow. Even though in this kind of a layup, air bubbles are not as big of a problem. I'd like not to induce any air bubbles. I'll put a couple of drops of black dye in here just so I can see my work a little better. And we're ready to start the layup. This is one of the products I've used as a thickening agent. It's extremely lightweight. It almost floats out of the can, in fact. But it's good for making a little paste, again, for the corners I'll be using to mix some of this. So the air bubbles rise to the top. Kind of give that a minute to get rid of all the air bubbles, even though we don't care. In this part, we don't care about. First thing I want to do is mix up a little bit of paste. And then I'll paint this into the corners. This is one of the parts, if you do the first mold you ever do, almost everybody leaves this step out and figures, I don't need that. I don't need to put a paste in a corner. I'll just put something. And then you realize you do need to make. Microballoons will work. Cabasil will work. Q-cells. This West product I found works real nice for doing exactly this. And it's kind of like you need to look at it and get it to be just about between mayonnaise and peanut butter. And that takes a little bit of practice. And you can see how I'm doing this. Nothing tricky here at all. use this product to make their epoxy thixotropic, so it would stick to a surface. You can see right now that would stick wherever you put it. Anyway, none of these products are real expensive. None of these are where you need to be a millionaire to lay up a cowl. In fact, the bargain is once you make the molds, when you make the second and third airplane, you've already probably got enough material to make six airplanes. So if you really were a fanatic, you could just mold them all up at once and have a lifetime supply of planes in your laundry room or something. Okay, that's about right. Now, right about there is when it kind of stands up on its own. Again, now what I do is I want to pack the corner. This is where it'll tend to fall down, is when it's in the corner of the mold. Around here, we want to put some extra because we're going to try to blend that in. And in the back, take a little scoop of this and get it down in the back. Anywhere that there's an angle or an edge, now that I've looked at it for a while, I see we really do have more than the amount of air bubbles I should have in this mold. And what I should have done is waited to get my vacuum box back to get rid of some of them, but in this case, since we're going to sand the part anyway, see, if you were making a boat, for instance, and you want that outer skin to be a finished skin, well, in my case, I don't care because I'm going to paint it. And for paint to stick, you've got to sand it with at least 80 grit sandpaper. So it's almost a waste of time to do that. Also, right along the edge here is where I like to build up a little extra. This always seems to be a spot where the final part, you always have a tendency to get a little thin right at the edge. So we're ready to just lay in some material. Now you could paint the mold first. Ooh, I got it in backwards, see that? You could paint the mold first, but it's easier because this is just going to be a surface. This isn't really even in here for strength. Like to get that to lay in there as neat as possible. This is the motion that you get used to doing, is just dabbing it into the corners, dabbing it into the edges. The fact that it doesn't match real well on the back is not a factor right now. I'm just taking the raw resin. It's going to soak through. This is a little bit time consuming because we don't have any resin in the mold. It just takes time, but this lets me get the first piece in relatively accurately. When you have a complex shape like this, it's easier to pack it in. Because once you have resin in a mold and it hits the resin, it's just difficult to get that last little piece to lay down. Now what we do when this part is cured and we take it out, that we post-cure it, it's called out of the mold post-curing. When you have a rubber mold, you really could probably, I think it makes the molds deteriorate though. I do the pipe, the tomb pipe parts, I do the post-curing in the rubber molds, but it seems to make them deteriorate. So I'm hoping this part is going to come out, because it'll cure at room temperature, but then it goes into its post-cure stay where it picks up extra strength. Getting up in all the corners and angles. Next thing I want to do is get this whole first layer of the light cloth in here. Then I can kind of see where it needs a second and a third layer. See, that's the advantage of having some dye. Now I'll probably wind up with 3 layers of 2-ounce cloth over the whole mold and then 1 carbon fiber big piece in there as a reinforcement. At some point in time, most of the resin starts running down, making a puddle in the bottom of the mold, and what I try to do is scoop that resin up and pack it in the corners, pack it in, and if I need to thicken it up, I just add a little bit of the number 406, but to get all the corners packed, that's before you actually put the second layer in. That's the most important thing that I've found, and then I'm going to just go take those pieces, one by one, drop them right in. As you lay the pieces of carbon, and carbon doesn't want to bend, so you want to have everything skinned out with the thin e-glass, and then I can trim this because it's not going to bend up over that ridge. I can pat this all down and then trim this back, and I'll have my carbon reinforcements in there. The last thing, I'm using a real low heat just to warm it up, because now, because the temperature in here is real cold, this will just get this to get a little thicker that it maintains its shape in the corners. The real problem here is the corners. And until this gets a little thicker than I'd like, just a little bit of heat. Now, if you were working in a shop that was 70 degrees, this would already have gone off. But it just gives me a little more open time to work this way. And anything that drains down into the bottom of the mold like this, I can pick it up. Use it along the edges. That's a good tip. Because we're going to eventually line the edges with 60-foot plywood anyway. So we have reached a point now where, once this dries, and we'll let it dry 24 hours, the next cowling we can make in probably an hour, hour and a half, 2 hours tops. And if there's anybody out there can carve a cowling, I can't, and not in 2 hours. So, and the other thing it does is anybody else building a Typhoon, Elliot Scott has already signed on to build a Typhoon. One of the things that allow us to do is the planes will all be very similar. Instead of each one being a little thicker and thinner and different, and this adds a measure of repeatability. Next thing is just put it aside to dry. It's got to sit 24 hours, and then we need to pull it out of the mold and post-cure it. Tip is you can put a fresh pair of gloves on and clean any of the epoxy that's still wet off of the scissors, especially off of the blades, because if you get little amounts of epoxy in it, it eventually works its way on there. And I would highly recommend, if you're working with any epoxy, any of these layup epoxies, rubber gloves just save so much time and energy in it, and you avoid getting this stuff, because epoxy will seep through your skin if you let it. You leave it on your skin long enough. I always get a little anxious. I always want to see what that mold's going to look like. I wish I could, you know, just look into the future tomorrow and see what it's going to look like. But if we're not happy with it in any way, the thing is, it'll be very easy to make another one and another one and another one. We basically, from this point on, can make one a day without any problem at all. Now, this just shows you something. Check this out. While we're waiting for that cowl to kick off and Mike to sand, I'm on the A-list. Look at this. Wendy Artnowski. Is that like Tinkerbell Artnowski? Anyway, what this is, every year I get a ghost calendar. Check this out. I love to look through these. I have one right by my desk from last year. We're going to get one for this year, too. A wonderful, wonderful thing if you have a shop and you like railroads. And there's always something about... I don't really know what it is about the railroads. The attraction to me, I don't know what it is. I wasn't a veteran in World War II, but I just love the airplanes that, from that period of time, the railroads. And just look at this one. What happens, once you buy one calendar, they put you on the list, and every year you get the little preview calendar. There's something about railroads. I really don't know how to define it, but there is something magical about World War II fighters. They make a lot of nice little products. Hey, Spitfire. P-51, Cadillac of the Sky. And over here, here's the address. Hope you're able to read this. And if you're in love with ghosts, get on the A-Team. Wendy Artnowski, I love it. Anyway, it's 800. I can't even read it. 331-8231. It's an 800 number. Tell me I love railroads. Pages of these hanging. Look at this, a P-51 with roundels. Got these all over the shop. I love having them. Speaking of cool railroads, this is from Al Rabe. He made these in 1970, the Tempest drawing, which led to the Sea Fury. Can you look at this tail hook? Hey, look at the sea mat. It looks like the Sea Fire. Anyway. And of course, his variation of the Tempest, which is the plane that came right after the typhoon. Anyway, Al, as always. Yep, now one thing I gotta tell you real quick. Al, you send things up here in PVC pipe. Rather than using a mail-in tube, we use a piece of PVC pipe. I love it. Pretty soon I'll have enough. I can replumb my whole house as long as I can get somebody to do the labor. Anyway, Al, thanks a lot. I'll send you some videos down today. Let me know if you have any cool ideas for the project. Doesn't look like we're off by much here. Anyway, really appreciate it, Al. Thanks a lot. Just thinking of just one thing that would be the ultimate cool, since Al still has the Sea Fury. Hey, nice big Sato 72 or something up in the nose there, maybe a throttle control. I don't know. We've got all our stuff geared around the Sato 72, but that would be a fun project. Again, I just love the interaction, and most of all, I love the warbirds. Now the trick here is, and I'm going by Ed Gallagher's ideas, I'm trying to press my finger down into the epoxy and I'm just leaving a fingerprint. I don't want it to go to be rock hard, an overnight thing. I want it to be that when I lay the cloth, I'm going to lay a couple layers of thin cloth on here and another batch of the same gel coat. I want to bury that, but I don't want the weave going through and I don't want it pushing air through. So I think I'm pretty safe in assuming this is ready to go. It took about 2 hours, by the way. Now, because the epoxy will bond better when it's in this state, it doesn't bond well at all once it goes to a full cure. So what I'm going to try to do is lay on a thick coat. And on this thick coat now, just drop in one layer of thin cloth, that thin tight weave cloth that we used on the cowling, and then maybe 4 or 5 layers of 6 ounce cloth, just to build up some thickness in the mold. Because these are small molds, we're not going to try to even use the foam method like we used on the wing. This is the most expedient way right now of just getting this done. Now, a lot of times what seems to work pretty well is just lay the cloth right on it. I always let it go oversized because I don't want the cloth to end or have a seam or anything in here. And of course, I want to make sure I don't have and make some paste up for the corners here. May need some paste in there. This coat then can be just brushed right on. And after this, well, we'll do the two pieces at once, of course. We'll cut the same thing in 6 ounce cloth. There's no real set amount that has to go on here. You just build up enough thickness. You know, the thing is, right now if I trap air, I've already got the skin on the mold, so it's a lot less of a problem than it's if it's in that surface. Then I'll leave about 3/4 of an inch of edge. Can draw this out before I lay in the 6 ounce cloth. Now I just heard the bird fly by and there's a problem. See, I always put the bird away before I do anything like this. Because what happens, he flies over here not knowing this epoxy's wet, steps in it, and then you can't catch him. He runs around like a human piece of flypaper. And then he just took a bath. Hey, I'm going to get Uncle Mike. Look at this. He's getting all his black feathers. A young adult. You stay away from my mold. You're getting down to the end of the 6 ounce cloth. I had a whole roll at one time, but you can see how much of this stuff we're doing. We use that on Nova Cowling. Hey, did you eat meat? I can't believe this guy. Get in that cage. I'm gonna have Ed Gallagher make a mold of you. Hey! He's getting all those black feathers. What good company he is in the shop, though. He just keeps me company all day long, makes messes for me. If I could only get him to wear a diaper, it would be so nice.
The layers are 6 ounce out. You just tend to just, it's easier just to pat them down into the first layer of epoxy. If necessary, I'll use a little heat gun if this starts to, looks like it's kicking off just about right. But again, we're in a cold shop environment. And what I'll do at the end of it is trim off the overage, whatever overage I have. Use that for extra laminations. Again, we just want to build a hard shell here that'll be relatively stable and have as few pinholes as possible. Now the idea of the heat is just to get it to flow a little better. I'd like to use as little resin as possible and as much cloth. Cloth is a lot cheaper than resin in bulk.
So you just lay the next layer right on top, layer by layer.
Pretty redundant from this point on.
Step that we really don't have to do. I have a sheet of Teflon, and what Mike is doing is getting some cans, some edges, just to pack the edge down. Just get them, you don't have to press like step on them, but get them as close. So here's the idea here, is get them right there, because it's that edge that'll be. Okay. And we'll do the same thing to the back mold. Well, you're ready to paint, right?
Yep.
All right. What a day. How many coats of clear do you have on this? After the tissue, three?
Three or four.
Okay, I put one on the other day, three or four. Mike sanded it all down with 320. And we mixed up some filler. The filler is as much talc will stay in suspension in 5 minutes. Brodak clear and Brodak silver in any denomination just to give it the silver color. You only need enough silver in there. Just we're going to sand this off, and the silver shows the flaws. And in this case, because Mike is anticipating making his whole plane candy apple, we need to have a real good base coat, a real good, actually, you should have it no matter what you do anyway. Covering nice?
Yeah.
Okay. Always a good idea to do the smaller parts first instead of the bigger parts. Try to use 20 pounds, 18 pounds. If it's nice and warm, use 15 pounds. The less pressure you can use, the better. And this is one of the guns that I've been selling, these Campbell Horsfield guns, and they've been working real well. And we also keep our high-end gun, the William Morey gun, for shooting clear. Sometimes holding it is part of it. I grab it by the horn. In other words, spray the whole thing except, you see what I mean? Now watch it doesn't blow out of your hand, famous last words. And then at the last minute, hold it by that wire. I guess we got a wedding going on over at the school, huh? Anybody you know getting married?
No.
Peeps is getting married. Okay, that's covering real nice. I think they should take all these teenage kids and send them to the Marines for about 2 months. Give them a trip to Paris Island. Boy, living next to a school has its downsides. Unbelievable. And needless to say, the coat of talc will let it dry overnight. All right. Hey, you learn quick. Yeah, watch him drop it. I'm dying to see him drop right in the mud, too. It's all muddy. Oh, man. Now, see, if you wanted to, you could make a little fixture to hold that. So what you could do is spray the trailing edge and then have a piece of iron aluminum with little tabs that would go in the hinge pockets. Hold it straight up. Since all the planes from this point on look like everybody I know is making a Miss Ashley tail for no matter whatever plane they build, it doesn't matter. Maybe we could gear up to make these tails in mass production, I don't know. Anyway, they really do work out well. That's one of the better things to come out of the Miss Ashley project.
Alright, pan away, big guy.
One second.
I remember somebody. I was painting this way, and one day I looked at all my clothes, I looked at my hands, I looked at my face. Saw that thing like from The Wizard of Oz, Windy the Tin Man. Yeah, I think that you got a good technique down there. All we want to do is show the technique we use. Now, when you were brushing on the clear, you put extra on the cap strips, extra on the edges, right? Okay, now while we're spraying, silver really helps you see the spots. It doesn't really help. Normally, we would never put the filler right on the soap stand, but in this case, we do it. Trying this as a little bit of a new technique.
And do the middle.
Now you want to do the ribs, all the ribs. And this is the part that, this is the part a lot of people miss. Let me get the tip.
Get those ribs. There you go. Just on the edge.
Okay, now see, you could give that 100 extra coats on the ribs. That'll keep you from sanding through.
Not too bad. Quite a feeling of accomplishment, huh?
That's it.
Feeling of it's time for coffee, I think. Works me like a mule all day.
Now this morning, this is all dry. That should be dry anyway. I'm peeling up, took off my... Yeah, it's dry. And all that was there for so that the cans didn't stick to the mold. Because what I want to do is I want to pull this up very gingerly. I don't want to just take, I have those little nylon wedges too. I want to try to release it around the whole edge. A lot of times I need to use those nylon, I've got it, those nylon wedges. And wedges that are made just for this purpose. Again, because you don't want to just beat the heck out of this.
In case we want to make the mold over. And this is kind of like tearing a phone book where you can, if you can't tear the cover, you can't, there it goes.
But these are a couple of bucks. I think Ed Gallagher gave me these years ago. Now it looks like what we've done is just pull this off. I need to, I'm probably going to lose this plug, but it's not a real complicated thing. What I'll do now is to get some of the PVA and just take this over in hot water. And usually the wood will soak and distort, and then we can pull that part out. Once that cloth is trimmed, you can see what's actually happened is the glue, because this has a really
not a good finish on it. It's kind of just pulled the finish off the wood. But it's because we're trying to do this on an economical basis. If you were doing this in a more, you know, where you're doing this for a living, you'd have an aluminum base plate or steel or something. And this would probably be permanently epoxied on. Whenever you're trying to do work and not spend a lot of money for the tooling, these are the compromises you have to make. And this is the things you can pick up off the video, is how to do a job like this without spending a lot of money.
No, it seems to work some of the time. It doesn't work all the time, of course. When you have a part like this, I don't want to just peel it and break it out. If possible, I want to be able to salvage most of the piece. And there's no real convenient way to get a nylon wedge in here. So what I do is I'll let this soak for half an hour or so. The wood will absorb moisture. It'll eventually loosen up around the PVA. And I found sometimes that even before half an hour. Then most of the time, you can, once the wood dries out, you can possibly, I wouldn't say always, possibly salvage the piece. Yeah, it's getting ready to go right now. I can hear it. Oh, here we go. And they make these nice little nylon wedges that don't destroy the mold, too. That's another nice feature. The hardest thing is when you're making a tune pipe to get it off the mandrel. If you use an aluminum mandrel, sometimes you can beat it to death trying to get it off. See, it's already starting to separate up here. But I'm just going to let the water do its work. Give it a half hour in the hot water. The water will do its work, and we'll come back to this in a little while, and it'll probably come right off. You can see, I wanted to show this on camera. I've got a little corner picked up. Oh, it popped right out. But see, the water had already seeped in there and done its job. And in reality, if we wanted to use this over, we just have to put a new edge on it. So we really do get to salvage this. In a roundabout way. Not that we really do want to salvage it. I'll put this in my collection of stuff that I may or may not want to use over. It's certainly not destroyed, but as with any molding thing, getting it out of the mold is always one of the emotional parts of the job. If you're always worried it's not going to come out. Now these little edges, this is usually where it doesn't, you just take it out with your fingernails. And then I'll go over to the saw and trim the mold so it's nice and clean, get all rid of these hairs. But the thing I think we have accomplished, is we have a relatively nice, smooth mold surface. And the thing is, we've made this for a very small amount of money, where if we were using professional tooling and aluminum plates and pins and dowels, and it would be very expensive. Doing it this way, for modeling purposes, is a very practical way, and it's very inexpensive. And you wind up, now this is six layers. That's nice and solid. That'll retain its shape well. Well, I always, and it's funny, I always feel a lot better once I get those plugs out of the parts. In this case, these are just small parts, and because we're leapfrogging, now the next thing I want to do on this is take this down to the saw, trim this off in the belt sander, and prepare these, and I can start doing the same routine that I did on a previous tape with the racks and the PVA. These need to be prepped. It's best to let them dry a few days, then do the racks, the PVA routine, and these will be ready for a layup. I'm really surprised how nice they did come out. They really are. Probably, some percentage better than the ones we've done in the past. So what we try to do, though, is each time upgrade just a little bit. So, and of course, when somebody else is trying to do this, provide them with the information that we've already had doing it. Now is just to make the trimming easier, is put a perimeter of masking tape around it, and then I can work off of that as my edge when I cut it with the saw. Thank you.
just so I don't cut myself or the person helping me cut himself while we're laying up the mold. Strictly to get a cosmetic clean edge on that. The next thing, when we get the whole perimeter, we'll trim this on a belt sander.
Now the first two molds are, I guess as successful as we can expect for this point. The cowling is outside being post-cured in our little oven that we have out there.
I like to do at this point, this edge here, it's hard to see, but is always a little rough. And of course, when you're trying to pull a molded part out, you want this to be as smooth as possible. Also, this has some really tiny, and they're from the PVA, little, I should have shown these before I got it red, little just pinhole kind of thing, not pinholes from bubbles, just little pieces of the PVA that had dried with without being perfect, and there's a little bit of a rough edge here. So I'm taking 1200 sandpaper, and this is a point where if you really want it to be, let me get that down, if you want it to be fanatical, and I don't because these parts will have to be finished, but if you were going to make a boat where this was going to be the finished hull, you would want this to be 1200 paper, buffed, maybe with Gorham's or with some part oil wax. You'd want to spend a lot of time on this. The reason I'm not spending a lot of time, and I'll settle for having a less than perfect finish, is these parts, when they come out, have to be sanded with 80 grit paper before we can get the primer to stick. So, just one of the things, once this is all sanded down, and I give this like 15 minutes or so in here, and most of all to get this edge a nice radius that I don't have little sharp spots on there.
Now one of the things we're going to use the part oil for too, on the first coat, see when this comes out of the, by the way, this is why you don't use gel coat to build parts, even though it leaves a nice surface, it has no strength until you get some chlor, even when you get chlor in there, it has no strength. Gel coat is a very weak resin. Anyway, if you look at one little part here, and this is the part that gets time consuming, maybe in half hour, an hour or so of just arm work, is we want to use, I want to get the whole mold coated. And once this dries to a haze, then I can buff it off. And I'm using the same method that Ed Gallagher has taught.
Well, it's the same method we use to prep everything.
But if you've never prepped the mold like this, we're going to use the PVA that's been thinned by denatured alcohol. It seemed to work good on the release for this. You can just get some idea how that would typically buff right up. We'll spend a little time getting this real nice because this will be the final surface except for the PVA and the final coat of wax before we lay up this mold. And again, it'll be four coats over the course of a day, and then the PVA will be prepping this mold for 2 days.
You just get some idea how that polished up.
The rest of the polishing will be this exactly the same as it was on the previous video. The prep that Ed Gallagher suggested, and we won't put all the videotape in that. We're going to take a look at the cowling, see how the post cures coming out. Time of year, our holly bushes making these great little grapes. I don't know what they are, little bushes, little things. And I feed these to the bird every day. We also have, and I don't see him here today, he's a mockingbird. He's kind of a family pet named Butch, and he's usually sitting in this bush eating berries. And you can see how that works in our little oven there. With three bulbs on, it'll get a lot hotter. We only need two bulbs to cure this resin, though, and that'll sit out there 16 hours. Of these holly berries. Yeah, where are you going? He's gonna hide up there. Anyway, by leapfrogging and burying, look at he has that berry. When are you gonna shave? Buzz Brodeck said you look like a criminal. Yeah, I love these berries. Keep feeding me. Get back from coffee. We get done from feeding that bird. We're gonna take the fuselage and start putting the finish on it with the CA. Now, somewhere in the past, there was a different way that we used to prep these parts, and I want to go over this real quickly. This is what I consider the old-fashioned way of doing it, and it was very time-consuming. You would start with a block, or in our case, build a fuselage, and you'd have to carve it to shape. Basically, that was one day. The next day, you would glass it, but then there'd be a time gap. This is the problem. There'd be a time gap where you had to let that dry 24 hours. And you'd re-sand it, put on some Bondo, fix the repairs, and basically you'd have to let that dry 24 hours. Then you'd prime it, and you'd have to let that dry 24 hours, or maybe less in warm weather. And then you'd do the wax routine, which basically consumes a whole day. And then the PVA routine, that basically consumes the better part of a day, before you were actually ready to make the layup of the mold. Now, I've gone over on previous videos the ways I've used for time management to get the most out of a day, again, because shop time is valuable. Now, one of the things that we've been able to improve on, this step right here, the glassing, and then the night it would take to dry, the resand was usually quite intensive. The Bondo, and that required drying either overnight or for a while, and then the primer. You can see what we've got. We've got a routine part of what we're doing, where there are four separate steps where it takes, you need to let it dry overnight. Now, the way we've gotten around that, and I'm real happy with the way it's worked out, is I've been using CA. I've gone from the carving stage to putting that thin skin of CA on, which there's no drying time, the drying time is minutes, and gone right to primer on the same day. So you can see I've pretty much eliminated three or four, no matter how you do it, overnight dryings by using this technique. I've skipped a lot of steps, and the end result is it's worked well. So this is the technique we're going to use on the fuselage plug now, and I know the way they show in magazines, and a lot of RC people use them, the method where they double glass it and Bondo it and everything. But this way, where you're going right over balsa skin, CA, and right to primer, this way is really, really a big time saver. And what it saves is time gaps where you have to let things sit overnight. Probably the biggest question I ever get asked from people that have watched videos for the first time, wow, you have so much time to spend in the shop. Oh my God, yeah. If they only knew. And maybe it's good they don't know. But the reason that a lot of things get done in a relatively short time in this shop is, first of all, because they have to, because I don't have all day to spend here. And because what's happening right now is a good example. Right now, as we shoot this video, the cowling is out in the oven being cured, and that's going to sit out there for 16 hours. So what do I want to do? Just sit around drinking coffee between now and then? I don't think so. My coats of wax are drying 2 hours apart, a la Ed Gallagher. These things are happening at exactly the same time. And I'm going to start, while those two things are happening, I'm going to get over there and try to get that hard skin shell on the fuselage plug. And possibly, even it's supposed to snow today, if it doesn't snow, one of the things we'll get to do is get the first coat of primer on there. But we've got three things leapfrogging together, and by doing this, rather than using up an amount of time in a shop that's astronomical, we're using up a very small amount of time. There's some museum photos from, these came in today from James Mills. And the thing, it's funny that I didn't plan it this way, but the thing I spoke to him about
because he's basically on a leave of absence from work and needs to have a minor operation, which is going to keep him home for a month. And I suggested a bunch of ways that he might be able to get a whole model built in that month if he used time management correctly. Anyway, he sent me these pictures. He's got a Cardinal kit. I don't know what he's doing with it. But this certainly looks like your stupid trick. A nice pipe. He also said in this museum they have a giant model railroad, and he took a picture. Obviously the pictures are not that good, but I always like to get everything on video, because then if somebody borrows the pictures or I lose them, then they have to worry. Oh, look. Spirit of America. Anyway, there are ways, if you have a gap of time, and I think Paul Walker wrote in the Stunt News that he had gotten laid off from work, or they were on strike or something, and he finished up his B-17. Well, using time effectively, so important, and that might be the biggest thing you ever can learn off of the videos. I don't know. Now, in the same way we've done the plugs, I'm using up some old, actually it's all Mike's old CA, and it can be old. It doesn't need to be new for this. Just putting that hard skin on the whole fuselage plug at this point. No kicker. And don't hold the rag in one spot or it'll kick off on you. And what we'll do is just work our way down the fuselage one step at a time. You get to do in the larger areas. A lot of times it's a good idea to put a set of rubber gloves on. And always a new paper towel with each swipe. And of course get some ventilation going with a fan. Don't breathe in too many of the fumes. You can really knock yourself out with the fumes. Anyway, I'm waiting for that fuselage oil, that CA to harden. And it's always good to let it sit a half hour. So Mike's taking his... Let me see how that's powdering right off. Boy, oh boy. Look at that. Right off. Okay. Now that's the silver filler trick that we've been using on the last couple of flames, and it's worked well. We make our own filler. Use the Brodak white primer sparingly in corners, over fillets, whatever, little spots, wheel pans, over composite parts, it's good. But basically the whole rest of it, using 320 to sand the filler out, this will be ready. Assuming you're going to work on this a couple hours, this will be ready to put a coat of real silver on real soon. That's the best system I know to get the primer on there. You make the silver primer and spray it on. Don't brush it. This is drying up, and I'm going to take this and sand it. And probably put another coat, maybe two coats on. Just sand this with 322. It gets that nice skin finish on it right away. One by one, the wax coats are drying up, so we got a lot of projects going on at the same time here. I'm just trying to pick up any little imperfections in here. I'll give this about three coats of CA, sanded between coats. Try not to get any flat spots in the top block. And what I'm hoping is that I'm going to be able to, because this is indented by, well, some amount, I may have to break this in half to pull it out. And we're going to find out. But I don't want to mold it without that, or I'll wind up with just a giant piece here that I have to add. Really don't want to do that. That might ruin the integrity. Now you can usually see, even after just a little bit of sanding, the texture is a little bit like 500 sandpaper or something. So I don't want to go through into the wood. And if I do, I have to hit it with some CA to build that hardness back, because I want that to be hard.
I always like to do at the very end on a top block, and this works real well, just do it. This picks up little high spots that you don't get using a flat block. It gets a little awkward if you're working by yourself. You got Mike out there imprisoned out in the garage where it's freezing cold. Anyway, I think you can get the idea here. And this really does add a nice smooth touch to the top that you can really pick up. You just see how nice and smooth that
That really gets rid of a lot of the low spots. I'm almost ready for primer here. It took about 3 coats of CA to get this all sealed up and hard. How careful you are. You always get these little spots, and these are the high spots. So what I do when I see that I've gone through here, I just want to touch up that, just that little spot. I don't want to have any spots where there's raw wood when I go to put the primer on. And you can do that as many times as necessary. You're just building up a hard shell skin before we put the primer.
You haven't used primer even for one day. The Rodak primer has a high solid content, so it all tends to sink to the bottom. It's really a good idea to stir it up with a screwdriver as well as shake it. And because we have a really cold day, actually it's pretty cold out there, there's ice everywhere. I'm going to try to get on a couple of thin coats rather than one thick coat, so it'll dry out a little quicker. You really want to try to avoid, in cold weather, getting on a real heavy, thick coat.
Now the trick is, in cold weather, the only trick I know that works well is light coats. Give each one a chance to dry. We'll get about 3 or 4 coats on here. In the meantime, just let them dry in between coats.
It's funny how in cold weather paint flows differently. Normally we could just put this on, 20 minutes later put another coat on. In cold weather that time is going to be dramatically longer. So it may be that we're only going to get one coat on today. So I want to get some silver on Mike's stuff. Trying to really make efficient use of the time, that's the whole thing. Not to waste any time, always have something. While this is drying, we'll be working on Mike's plane, getting that next coat of silver sanded out. And I guess that's the biggest part of time management, is always figuring out while I'm doing this, I'm already thinking of what the next thing is going to be. Now I can see, I got a little spot up here where I didn't seal the wood. A little spot up there. Put a little of that green putty in there later. I got another little fingernail mark over here needs to be filled in. But since we're going to be putting so many coats on, it won't even matter. Alright, as soon as you're done sanding out that, are you sanding out with 320, the whole thing? Don't sand the silk span at all, just sand right up to it.
Right.
And you'll throw the next coat on there.
Rich is making, this is a little sidebar to our project, because we're making a hurricane, Rich has decided to make a Stuka from a Cardinal kit. Look at this. I originally thought this was a dog biscuit. What is this, a canopy mold? Look at this.
Well, that's why I want your assistance.
Yeah, of course, no problem.
You got relatives in the office?
How much money you got, Rich? You got a steady job? I know he's got that big business with all those lays and everything. All right, come on, let's see what this is supposed to be. Anyway, what Rich is doing, he's trying to figure out how to make a canopy mold.
There's a canopy.
Okay. Is this back? Well, yeah, this is the way it goes, right?
Now, here's the...
Show me the side view. Don't show me this view.
Yeah. I'll give you the back.
Yeah. You have to have documentation.
There's a...
Well, Matt Newman, he's probably got a mold.
No, he doesn't.
Thing.
He doesn't. I'm telling you.
Oh, man.
Okay,
let's see what it looks like.
Oh, here, like this goes.
Oh, it's way off. Here's the problem that you have. It's much too long. See how high this is? Here's what's missing. By the time you put this down on the fuselage, you got to cut this half more.
Right.
The thing will be an inch high.
Sorry.
It's
going to
look like somebody sat on a... you
got to
build more
depth.
Right. And what you got to do is get a fake top block here and then blend it in so that this is... The height is okay, but it can't sit down on the fuselage.
Well, I understand.
You got one of those molds or something?
No, I don't.
Trying to show Rich is with this, he needs to build this up, but you got plywood parts here. You could make these out of plywood.
What do you mean?
See how this piece here?
A real Stuka has a...
You could make a piece of 60-foot plywood that would just go down.
Oh, down below.
Right.
So in other words, Midgley is just going to make the plastic, and then the plywood, I can put...
No, you got to, when you're done with this, this has to look like the Seafire mold. It's got to be finished. That's the one that you do that with lead. Lead and plywood, yeah. You could. This is Stay-Brite solder, and this is 64 plywood. I could give you the tape for how to make that. But here's the thing. This has to sit up. Or once you take that, see where the curve is up here? Right.
Okay, I see what you're saying.
So make a fake top block, like 12 inches long. Just put the curve in it.
And glue it to this.
And then all around the side, build up the details. You see the details? All these different doors and hatches? Because they'll all come out in the mold.
So this, I got to put another piece underneath this.
Yeah. It's all done how that's, the solder comes out in the mold.
That's the Titanic in great shape.
That's one of the ones Midgley made. He made that. That comes similar to this. But you got to get this part mounted, and then we'll make a rubber mold for that, and you'll be, and you,
okay, you can torment Matt Newman, and you can charge him $50 for a canopy.
Well, it'll be nice. That'll be a cool thing.
Okay, I'm gonna
take one and take it home with you and look at it.
Now, one of the things today, we're going to try to leapfrog our way into the frog pond or something here. One of the things that's worked extremely well, and I was not aware of this until Ed Gallagher had told me in those tips of his, was that you could thin the PVA, and I wanted to make sure I include this in on the video, because this was a significant thing. It lays out a whole lot nicer than when it's in full strength, and certainly a lot more convenient than spraying it. Another thing, if you leave PVA in a gun, which I've done, it totally corrodes the gun. The whole inside of the gun will become a mess. So you really have to load the gun and take it out every time, something I was looking to avoid. And I had used that gun a very short amount of time, and it really was in rough shape. The PVA destroyed the gun. So what I'm real happy about is now that I can do it this way, and the trick was to thin it. Thinning it with denatured alcohol, 50-50. Again, this is what I like about working with other people that have already crossed this bridge, already done this type of stuff. The fun of it becomes that you find out one thing, I find out something else, and we both know more than if we didn't share the information. It's like a win-win situation. And I was glad to see, let me say this, Doran Morisau, who we've kind of taken under our wing in the last couple of years, I guess that's the right word, since we rescued him from living in a car. And he's been real good about sharing it, and I think he's going to send me a video real soon about the project that he's working on, and I hope that's going to happen. Because every time you can add one person into the mix, everybody wins. Everybody, even Bob Dixon, when he sent those the tips for the ribs, every one of those... Every piece of video you can get from people, Fred Cronwett is supposed to send some tape down of the flying stunt with his throttle control system. Everybody you can get to join the team gets stronger. And the essence of it all is everybody wins. Now, I've laid this first coat out. I did this on purpose so you can see my technique for laying it out. And again, I'll let this is going to take a whole day. I'll let this dry, put another coat on, let it dry, put another. Ed said you could also spray the coats on. I'm going to brush them all on just to see how that's going to work. Okay, now while this is drying, I'm going to go get the cowling and the fuse plug from outside and see what works. See, as one thing is drying, I'm working on the next thing. This is a quick way of how to get rich early in life. Don't do what I did. Yeah, taking this out of the oven, you can see it's pretty well stuck in. Now what I found is we always take it out of that little garage first, of course. I want to peel these pieces back little by little rather than try to rip the part out and see if there are any spots. There's always spots where it's going to stick, especially on the first pull.
Oh,
So there's our first part. Now we're going to sand the, this looks like I have a lot of little air bubbles trapped in there. And over here there's a bad spot. But certainly for the first pull, it tests the mold. We know the mold is going to work now. And that part is nice and light too. I prep the mold, put the spray smooth on release agent in there. What I'm going to do is when I get to a gap in the day when everything's drying, I'll lay up another cowl. Now I know from looking at this cowl, I know one of the things I need to work on is getting that corner. This is where it kind of pulled away. Now, because we don't really care about the surface, this is all going to get sanded. We could easily use this part, just lay in some epoxy in there, it wouldn't even matter. This would be a totally serviceable cowl. But what I want to do is, for my own benefit, I want to practice with the mold, and because I'm going to make several of these, I'm going to make some for Elliot and some for just for, to have one in stock. And what I'll probably do is anytime I get a gap in a day, I'll run off an extra cowling. And then if anybody wants to look at one of these or put one in their hand, feel it, touch it, we'll have extra ones, just like when we did the development on the landing gear and the wheel pants. We'll have extra parts. We can pick the best one for the model. It's another thing you can always do, and I'm just thinking of things. This one has the carbon. I can make one up with all e-glass with no carbon, just to see if it's a lot more rigid. Again, carbon is usually more rigid, but in this case, it's such a complex shape, getting that carbon to bend in corners is really difficult, so it may be that I can actually make the part lighter by using all e-glass. But I'll make a few of them, and then by picking the best one for the model, keep the second best one for a backup, or whatever. See, now this is the part that's nice about molding. At this point in time, we're only about 20 minutes away, half an hour at most, from having a whole new cowl. Try that with get a block of wood this size and pretend you weren't happy with the cowl and start carving another one. The guy that's molding is going to win every time. So we've paid this price up front, but now for all eternity, until we ruin the mold or lose it or who knows what, we can from this point on make Typhoons on a relatively, and another thing, if somebody else is making a Typhoon from Elliot's plans, we can supply them with a cowling. I mean, that's going to save them a lot of work. Let me give you a good tip, and this really will save your eyes and everything. Before you do a trim and get off the excess, it's always a good idea, at least I find it is, to take an old pair of those scissors that you seem to always wind up with about 20 pairs of in the shop, the ones that don't cut paper anymore, actually don't cut anything, and get rid of this extra stuff. Reason is, when you're running a Dremel tool to make that part and it catches a thread, it usually pulls the Dremel tool into the part or into your hand, and it's a safety thing. Get rid of all the loose material, loose threads, whatever you can. And then what I do is I use a parting wheel. Never use those little saw blades. Let me put this on the tape too. These little things that have saw teeth on them, when these catch, you lose a finger. When these catch, you can run them into your hand, you get this. When these catch, you're on your way to the hospital. So, my good suggestion, one of the suggestions worth having, get rid of all the extra material. So now when you're doing a parting line, you're not prone to catch an edge. By the way, they make these wheels in thick sizes and thin. The thick seem to work a little better. If I were not shooting video, I'd be wearing a mask and eye protection. If you're ever doing this, if you're doing this and it catches one of these threads, boy, does it, and it scares you to death. Off all the extra material. Now what we'll do is just run that on a belt sander to get a nice straight edge. even though this is probably not going to be an official part, we'll get, number one, the things we can get from this is a good weight, and we can start getting a feel for how many layers or what material we want to use to make the part, since this is about twice the size of a normal cowl. Goes without saying that anytime you sand carbon fiber, wear a mask. Trouble is, I've tried in the past wearing a mask while I'm shooting video, and what sounds like, and my voice is not that clear to begin with. Anyway, this looks like if we were going to use this part, this would be a repairable piece. You could just take a little bit of epoxy, lay it right over this. You'd rough this up with 80 grit paper. Rough it up. Next time you lay up a cowl, just paint, and that's exactly what we're going to do, by the way. I'll rough this up, and then there's some little dimples here that you can just peel these off with your finger. And actually, these little pinholes and little things, these little imperfections in the mold, I'm not even worried about these, because this would get, the final part is going to get sanded. And you really have to sand any composite part, especially something that's going to take some flexing and heat, with 80 grit paper. Prime it, 80 grit, prime it three or four times to get that tooth, that mechanical tooth you need, so that the finish is stuck down real well. Just getting some idea how that looks like it's going to fit. That looks like it's going to be fine. As I said, as soon as we have some spare time, we'll lay up a few more of these cowls and then pick the best one. Now this is dried up well. You can see one of the things we have, some runs in a primer. I try to shoot a lot of primer up into that little repair spot, but runs don't mean a whole lot. But the first thing I want to do is get some 320 paper, knock this all down. Thousands of high spots will come up. As soon as I see high spots coming up, I'll give it another coat of primer. And little imperfections like this, it really doesn't mean much. Now I test fit the cowl to see if it fit in place. Everything looks like it's relatively good. But if you really want it to be fanatical here, one of the things you could do is actually make the cowl and put the cowl, glue it right in place and do a little more sanding. I'm not concerned with that because these parts come out light enough to begin with. And if that were to not line up, I would just add some 1/64 plywood or add a little doubler right inside of the carbon material. About as much as I can take off. As soon as I see that I've gotten, so you can see all the little dents in the ball, so the primer fills in. In any spot, here's a spot that I had a little imperfection in. Using that 3M putty to just, you can see some grain here. Watch what happens when you. No, you don't even need a block to get the grain out. Okay, here it comes. Now you can see how it's filled it in. But I don't want to go any further. I don't want to go down through the CA. You can see how that Brodak primer just powders right off. To show how the little spots that we're repairing, whenever I go over that, the 3M material,
sanding block it, it blends right into the Brodak primer. But the trick is not to go down into the raw wood. Don't go any further down than you have to fill in the imperfection. And when I'm doing this, I use my hands. Your eyes are kind of, because of the way this molts, it's hard to see, but you can feel, especially in the first few coats. Once you get to, see right here, there's an imperfection. And again, the temptation is you don't want to sand too far down and you don't want to hit the raw wood either. You want to leave that CA skin. That feels just about right. But do the whole thing by hand. Especially we know this area up here is going to need a little work. We had a little gap where I didn't have the glue joint wasn't filled. But your hands really are your best way of finding imperfections.
Okay, she's ready for the next coat of primer. And then, the point is then it's going to sit 24 hours. I like to get as many imperfections out of it in each coat as possible, of course. And knowing just how much to sand off, the key here is not to sand it all off. If you sand it all off, you've defeated the purpose. You want to just sand off till you see the high spots coming through, and then go with another coat. Just keep knocking down the mountaintops and filling in the valleys. Now tonight I'm going to sneak down here for another little session. First thing is I touched this up with a little green, the 3M putty. And I'll kind of let this dry, give this overnight to dry. But in the meantime, I want to run a little test on a mold. I cut up a test piece of carbon, 2.94. I cut a test piece of Nomex. And what I'm going to try to do, and this is just really an experiment, is laminate it in between this and the 2 ounce e-glass, and then figure some way of compressing it down with the leader cloth in between and some kind of compression system on top, maybe some rolled up newspaper or whatever. I have some Teflon sheet out here. I'm going to lay out the epoxy resin and kind of make my own prepreg with, even if this isn't an experiment, at least this will be drying and I'll have some test parts. But notice I have everything all cut up and ready to go. Famous last words. So without wasting any time, I'll use the same resin system. Lay this up, post-cure it tomorrow, and actually 2 or 3 days from now, we'll have a test part. And this will be part of our getting used to using a Nomex. Now I'm using up scraps, for anybody that's never seen Nomex. And next Saturday, Dave Midgley and his dad will be down here with 2 4x8 sheets of this. So this is what we're going to try to make the flaps out of and use it maybe somewhere in the fuselage. We don't know yet. More on Nomex later, but first we want to run a little test on this piece here. First thing I'm going to do is, in essence, make my own prepreg here. I'm going to saturate this, trowel it off, and squeeze it between two sheets of Teflon to try to minimize the amount of resin that's in here. Again, this will probably be a test piece, but we're going to learn. Now, we may need 2 layers of this. We could always use this in a non-Nomex fashion, do a Miss Ashley fuselage with no Nomex at all. But we want to, because we can compare the weights of the Nomex against the no-Nomex parts. Now it's always good to do. Flop it over. We can pretty much figure where this is going to go. But we want to leave enough resin on it with saturated. I don't want to squeeze it out to where there's no resin in it either. We need enough resin in here that the Nomex is going to stick. It'll make a good bond. I don't know if
we're really going to be able to drop this right in there the way I'm anticipating. The only corners we have to deal with are in the corners up this way, and that's not really a factor. And that's why it's important, I guess, to get as nice a piece cut where we don't have a lot of overage. Again, I need to leave enough resin on here, same as when I do a flap. It's the amount of resin that stays on here. You can't have it bone dry or you don't get any bond to the Nomex. I can mix up some paste and stick it in the corner if I want to at the very end. I think that's going to lay in there fine. I've dipped the sheet of Nomex onto the Teflon sheet. You can see how it's picked up the glue. I shouldn't say the glue, the resin. Now I want to make sure, this is the side that I haven't touched. I want to make sure I have a decent amount on here too. So again, if it's not sticking, then it's just extra weight going along for the ride. Let me just pick this up and make sure I have a good amount of resin on both. Now this has ripe spots. I'm going to have to dip it back down until I get rid of all of these dry spots, or I can take a sponge and just sponge it on. This may help. I've just troweled out some resin on here. And what I'm going to try to do, just to get a little bit better. There we go. I can even see that that's better. There's a point at which it's like anything else. It's too much and then not enough. Okay, that looks a lot better. I know, that's what the captain of the Titanic said. That's just right. So right around that iceberg. Okay, we're ready. Because without that bond, there we go. And see, this is the part I have to get a feel for. And this is why we're doing little parts before we're laying up a wing where there'd be $400 or $500 worth of material in one layup. This is relative to a wing, is very inexpensive. Okay, now we have, let me wipe my hands here. Have some idea of how much is on there, that we have a good bond on all the parts. And the next step, of course, is to drop this in here. Now, we need some way of pressing this down, and this is where I need to get a little inventive, creative, because again, I know it won't go up the curve. This is not XO. If I had XO, means it'll expand in one direction. If I had XO, I could bend it up the sides. Because I just want to do a test piece, and this is a scrap piece. Now what I'm going to do is take that 2-ounce cloth and saturate it with resin the same way and then compress it in there. And I'm making sure I get this good and wet, but not super saturated. Not dripping and drooling like a candle either. And an easy way to do that, of course, is because we're working off Teflon. We know we can get a pre-described, predisposed. You know, I really should have paid attention in high school to what these big words mean. Anyway. We are truly looking forward very soon to a visit from Don Dixon of Little Rock. And we really are... We're going to put him to work, though. He thinks he's coming here for a big pizza party. Literally finds out we put the gloves on him as soon as he gets here. Okay, by the way, he has the second Z-tron in the world is owned by Don Dixon. Okay. Because it's an experiment, we'll just go with that. I don't know how practical this is going to be again. I can see one thing already. This is a little bit labor intensive. Okay. Now you might be thinking, why not use two layers of carbon? Well, that is one of the choices. But because this is a test piece, that's a tentative problem I have to work on. I can work on this because I can put Teflon on the edges. Or if I had Mike or somebody here, one of my helpers. Okay, now the trick is, once this is laid in the mold, this is the easy part. See, this is the part that, you know, anybody really can do this. I'm going to spread this out. I want to take a piece of, this is bleeder cloth, and what it does, it lets the resin come right up through it. And now I have to invent something to press down on here, to put pressure on that. Pretty crude, but because we're doing a test piece, rolling up paper towels might be enough to press it down, and we'll just get a weight on top of it to roll these up into a ball. A sponge would actually be good. Now that I've already mixed the resin. Well, the better way of compressing this down would be maybe with a piece of soft balsa. This is 32nd balsa. Now I can pack it down into the corners a little better. That'll work. See, I need weight on here. Now what I really need is a piece of sponge. A sponge is what I need. Now we just put that piece of balsa wood, some paper towels. I don't have any big high hopes for this. It's just a test piece anyway. And we're just using up the scraps. I'll lay the other 104 off camera. Maybe even get another cowl laid up here. Okay, we got another cowl waiting to come out of the mold for tomorrow. This test piece and the tail piece. Babysat this, and believe me, this... See, this is the stuff when you do it the first time, you say, whoops, can't do it that way. I never realized I'm going to need such a fancy gizmo to compress that Nomex. So what I'm going to do in the future, I'm going to make something like maybe a rubber plug. Maybe I could use molding rubber. But some kind of plug or some kind of sponge. Now what I did, this is the cradle that we use to work on a plane, and this is a box from SIG that has 25 kits in it, the laser cut parts. So what I've done, it's a real heavy box. You need two people to pick that up. It's awful wood. What I've done is use that for compression, and the sponge, let this sponge just go down and conform to the shape. Now what I'll do, maybe if I even have some heavier stuff on here. Anyway, just to try that, in the future what I'll do, I'll go buy some sponge, see? That's the part I didn't know yet. And, well, we'll learn it as we go along. We'll see how these come out tomorrow. And it looks like we're closing in on having most of the flaws fixed on this. Maybe one or two coats of primer and this will be ready. I got some pictures here from Warren Walker. These are some nice pictures of his latest project, and I have to tell you, Warren, we're still enjoying the pickles you sent us. Warren makes his own homemade, not sure if we should call them Polish pickles or not. Anyway, he's making a, now notice the Pathfinder has a four-stroke. And he's been testing this engine out. This is the one he called me right from the field, trimming the plane. Anyway, it looks like a nice paint job on there, too. One of the new Brodak kits, the Pathfinder. Anyway, he also sent a box with some parts in it. I need to look at those box. Oh, look at this. Is this cool? One of these videos. What you should have, Warren, is a big circle there with a smiley face upside down. Anyway, check this out. He's got the Magnum 53 going on here. Now look at the, just to show you what Warren's helped me out with here. See, all the four strokes have about a 45 degree angle in the exhaust pipe, but we wanted to see if we could make one with a 90 degree. And I sent some Sato parts out to Warren to modify, and it looks like we have them back until, let's hope that they're in that box. Hope Warren didn't send another jar of kielbasa or something. Anyway, in front of Warren's house. Really nice house. See, this is what I like about the videos. You know more about a person from video than, I don't know what the right word, you know, you, other mediums, you just see a flat picture. And of course, the now famous Sophie. Sophie, you and Peeps should get together and get a contract going. Hey, look at this. Oh, look at the fish pond, Warren, I'm proud of you. Peeps would be so proud of you. Look at that fish pond. And you thought Wendy was the only one dumb enough to make a fish pond. Anyway, his backyard. Now Rancho Cucamonga, I gotta tell you what I would do. We'd get, make it Rancho Bulldozer and get rid of all these houses. Make your own flat. Then we really would be impressed. I am impressed. Look at this grill. Now Warren, I gotta tell you, I'm jealous. I definitely cannot never move to Florida, to California. I can't move anywhere because my mother insists that I call her every day and a long distance calls would kill me. Anyway, look at the deck. This is what's nice when you live in a warm weather climate. We're getting ready for our first big snow of the year, and these guys are running around in their bikinis out there. Okay. Pathfinder, four-stroke. Ken Smith's Pathfinder on four-stroke. Going to Windy. I love it. We definitely send one of these into Pampa. That's funny. Anyway, there's Chipmunk. The big thing is we want to look in the box. Let's see what's in the box here, Warren. And I see we have this is a Sato 72 exhaust. And Warren did his thing with a night, made a 90 degree bend. It looks like he did a pretty cool job, too. And take what he also welded on a Stinger. Now the rubber ones definitely do not last. They do not stand the test of time. But what I'm thinking is once this is inside the cowl, if it fits, it may not fit, we don't know. We could bend this around anywhere we want. But anyway, we're gonna test this once we get some flights on tradition again. But I don't hold out any high hopes that we're going flying this week. They're planning the first big snow of the year. It's coming. This is welded on. These are stock Sato parts. Modified by Warren Walker, and we're gonna, see what we need to do is run this on tradition and see if there's any RPM loss with this system. Sometimes when you put a Stinger of any kind on, you get an RPM loss. And Warren also sent me, another jar of pickles. No, just kidding, guys. This is a tubing bender, and I guess I could bend this a little more, I'm not sure. I think we'll leave it just the way it is for now. Anyway, we'll be sending this stuff. Warren, I think this is going to be totally adequate. Anyway, we'll get to check this if we ever get a break in the weather here, which looks highly unlikely right now. One thing I always like, I always get excited when the UPS man comes to the door and has a giant box the size of a coffin for an elephant here. But what's in there is, and we've had some changes made to the Cardinal kit to update it and improve it. And we have the first batch of laser cut parts in here. And boy, if you've never seen laser cut kits, looking in here like I'm going for jewelry or something. Anyway, laser cutting, it makes our Cardinal kit and all the other ones that are laser kit just so much better than the ones that, maybe old-fashioned kits that don't fit. I know John Brodeck has his dies laser cut. One of the reasons his kits fit so well. But so much better than just the old hand-cutting kits. And when you see a box of them sitting like this, boy, it's beautiful. Now, the most fun you can ever have with balsa wood is punching out and sorting out thousands and thousands and thousands of parts. And this is why I've lost my mind over the years. Anyway, we're going to start putting our new kits together. We can still get one out to you by Christmas if you're really looking for one. Test pieces that we've already run. I went over these before, but I wanted to see. Now, we put it under a lot of weight so you can see the imprint of the Nomex down into the surface, so I know. First thing I've learned is I don't need that much weight to bond an Omex. Now I knew the edges of this were not going to be right because I didn't have a female part to fit in this, but this basically being a test, just using a piece of balsa wood in there. Now the peel ply, one of the things, this blue material is called, among other things, peel ply, but what it allows me to do now if you look at the texture of the surface, you'll see the texture of the material. This is a perfect glue bond surface. Doesn't even have to be sanded for when we want to lay formers in. Again, after looking at this part, I'm not real happy with the bond. The bond to the Nomex is not good on this part. But we get it, we can use it as a test, and I can sand this in and fill this, but what I need to do is make make the reverse cut on this one before I lay up another piece. And one of the thoughts I had is I could fill this with molding rubber and pretty much simulate that curve. Among other things, that thought had occurred to me. Dave Midgley is going to be here this weekend with some 4x8 sheets of real, I'll call it real Nomex. This was our sample parts. But by laying this up, a couple of things that are real apparent. Now, I've got the bond to the Nomex is not good. See how that's moving? That's not a good bond to the Nomex. So I want to tear this apart and see how much it takes to rip it apart. But maybe that Nomex is not appropriate for this piece to begin with. Or it could be that because we didn't put it under even pressure. Over here we have a good bond. You can see the bond, but over here we don't. We do lose. We lose torsion. If we were making a flap, this would be unacceptable. But the bond to the part that we care about, the bond here, is fine. And what we have is, this is only one layer of carbon now. And it's got the, it's retained its shape. So maybe, in essence, we don't even need this back piece to be like this. Maybe this isn't even a factor in this piece, but this is not going to be a final piece anyway. But at least now I can also get a little idea of what, how much this part is going to weigh. I can trim it all off, get a rough idea of the weight. Now, the second cowling I laid up, I put extra material in it, and it came out a little on the heavy side. Choices are obvious. You can sand inside and outside, but in my case, it's easy. I'll make up a cowl with a few less layers of the glass and carbon. So I can vary the part. If this part is too heavy, well, you know, some of the things I can do is maybe make it with no-no-mix and just some other, maybe a little piece of balsa reinforcement. But since this is basically just a cosmetic part, I'm not going to spend a lot of time worrying about the cosmetic parts on this. But you can see it did, from the mold, we did get a real nice finish out of it anyway. Well, actually, you could probably polish that up and use it. Looking at this for a while, one of the things I can surmise is what's happened, and it's one of the things I have to learn about using Nomex, is I've compressed it here, and I've also compressed it here, and it kind of stretched away from the Nomex. Over here, where it seemed to get a bond, so I'm going to have to be real careful either to cut a rubber piece or a sponge or something to compress that Nomex down. See how it's got a great bond here? It bonded right through. But right over here, it kind of pulled away, and I think what's happened, it's the way I had this compressed. So, for a test piece, it's fine. The same thing with the tail piece, and I'll do the same thing on this off camera. We have two test pieces, and we've learned another little significant thing, another little piece of the puzzle. What I think really happened here to this part, from looking at it, is when I put the sponge in here, and we had a pretty makeshift thing, it was really to test, is it locked down nice here and gave us a good bond here. But what it did over here, it pulled this material up away from the Nomex. And so I like to know, and this is how you, believe me, I wish there was an easier way to learn. But this is the way you learn. Now, in a perfectly flat surface like a flap, it would be a lot easier to confine it. But in this way, the way we're doing this, we're going to have to, and especially in that wing mold, because when Dave is here, and that's going to be probably in 2 or 3 days, he's going to be here, we're going to want to lay up a wing. And one of the things I can see is I need to really pay strict attention to how to get this piece to lay in there properly and make that bond. Now, where it made the bond, again, solid as a rock. This is, you can't bend this at all. But over here, of course, because you don't have a good bond. And there might be other tricks to this. One said Gallagher reviews the videos and some of the other people that have experience with this. But since we want to use this even in our fuselage, we want to make sure we have the best possible technology. But this is how I've learned. This is how I've learned stuff that's, there's no school to go to. You just can't dial up 1-800-DIAL-MOLDING-SCHOOL. It isn't going to happen. And by learning this the hard way a lot of times, and in this case, see, cosmetic things like this, it's a snap to fix that. It's not a problem. But it's these binding things. On a fuselage, I would want that binding real good. But we also have even a better thing. And that is, if Nomex doesn't work out in this, we can go back to making a fuselage exactly the way we made Miss Ashley's, where there was no Nomex. So it'll just set back our wing development program, but we'll be working on this constantly in the very near future. As I've analyzed the second part, it looks like my my decision was correct, because in the back here, where we have good contact, the part is really perfect. But up here, where it tended to pull the material off, not good. But I guess that's just, that's the next part of our learning curve is we have to, before we lay that wing up, we need to have a real positive way of pressing that Nomex down right in position. And I'm trying to come up with some way of maybe getting a piece of sponge exactly that size and then laying weights on it. But again, what would be nice if you had a compression mold at exactly that contour. Yeah, there's a lot of choices, but you want to, I'm trying to figure out the one that's the most practical for my purposes. And this stuff just takes time. Every time that I try a new technique, I almost know ahead of time I'm not going to get something this complex right on the first shot. But the thing that I have going for me is I just keep trying different ways until I find something that's usable for my purposes, and just to never give up. I always do is mark up the test parts, even though I don't put a finisher on them, the test numbers. Same thing with the cowling, so I can get a, when I go back over this, I make little notations, go back over it and I can see, you know, just what progress I've made. And certainly now that we have two cowlings, I can really kind of really zero in. The next one I make should be a keeper, because I've got one that had a little problem with the finish, the other one, the finish is perfect, but the weight is a little on the high side. I went with 6 layers. I'm going to try using 4. I think 4 will even be overkill, but for a cowl, you know, that's going to take a lot of beating in the course of the plane, so a couple of grains up there really shouldn't make a big difference.
Things, anytime I run a part on these molds, actually the truth is the more you use a mold, the better it gets. When it's new, they call it a green mold. The PVA usually comes,
just wanted to show this,
PVA will come off, but I always want to start with a clean surface now. And now I don't need to re-wax this right away. I can see there's still plenty of wax on here. But I will redo the PVA. And this is part of time management, is getting this. And while this is drying, I'll lay up another cowling. So that I'm never waiting. I'm never just sitting in limbo waiting and have nothing cooking away. You see how nice that's retained to finish there? You can see the reflection. This, when it's had 3 or 4 or 5 pieces pulled off it, then I'll do the re-waxing job.
One of the things that's really worked well, again, is this thinning the PVA with denatured alcohol. And even more important than this is, I'm going to run up a test, well, we won't get this finished today, but I want to keep running test pieces on this, because you understand, before you lay up a wing, and I'd like to, for instance, one of the things I haven't done is take one of these little guys and vacuum bag it. Maybe the vacuum bagging is the way to go with the Nomex. Look at this, I have to pick a piece of junk into the mold. But maybe vacuum bagging is the way to go here, and I just haven't realized it yet. But we're sure going to find out.
And that's the part Dave Midgley has played in the program. He's provided us with the vacuum bags, the pump. And so while he's here, it'll be very interesting to see if we can run some tests on that.
But the third in the series of cowl layups, I was very, very meticulous to try to see if 4 layers of tight weave are going to be enough. It'll be very, see, usually I can tell how heavy a part's going to be by how much of the resin is left over at the end of the layup. Just a rough number. I'm looking for, you know, obviously the lightest part I can, but I don't want to sacrifice any strength here, because in that scoop, I don't want it that every time you pick up the plane, it's going to oil can either. So I'm willing to pay maybe 4 or 5 grams of extra weight. But I'll now, at the end of this, when this dries, I'll have 3 of them, and I'll have a real good gauge of do I want 6 laminates, 4 laminates, or something in between. Probably what will happen, I'll wind up with 5. But that last laminate, you can see the cloth, there's not much extra resin on there. So that should be a relatively good one, and I might even make an extra one just to see how far I can push this before it gets too weak. One of the nice parts about oil molding is what happens when you make a wooden part. For instance, Mike's wing. Here's Mike's wing drying out. Coat of filler, coat of silver, dry. Now you weigh it and it's a certain weight and you say, oh gee, there isn't a whole lot you can do at this point in time. It's either too heavy or the right or whatever. But you can't make a radical change. But the option you have with molding is you mold up a part. It takes relatively short amount of time. And if it comes out too heavy, too light, not heavy enough, whatever, you just make another one. Once you get to that point, it's relatively simple to make a replication of a part. It doesn't involve all of the work that a normal wood part normally takes. Well, we're coming up on the last minute or so of tape. I want to thank everybody for joining us. Please share the information. And if you have some ideas that you think you'd like to contribute, please send them in. I'll give them a try. We're open to suggestion. We're trying to learn, and whatever we learn, we're trying to share. That's our objective here. Again, thanks a lot for joining us. Boy, I can't say it over and over enough. The friends I've made, it's just been a wonderful thing having the medium of video to share this event with.
I see the wisdom.